Today, as we gather, we begin with Psalm 100. Hear now these words. Make a joyful noise to God, all the earth. Worship God with gladness. Come into God's presence with singing. Know that the Most High is God. It is God who made us, and to God we belong. We are God's people and the sheep of God's pasture. Enter God's gates with thanksgiving and courts with praise. Give thanks to God. Bless God's name. For God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. And God's faithfulness to all generations. May God grant us wisdom and understanding to this passage. Amen.
And thank you, Ginger, for reading the scripture this morning. Hello, everyone. So today is the last Sunday in what the lectionary calls ordinary time, which started all the way back at the beginning of June with Pentecost. Now, I don't know about all y'all, but looking back over the past 6 months, I don't see what was so ordinary about any of it. More importantly, this Sunday, today, is officially the New Year's Eve of the church year. It is the last word on our walk through the Jesus story in the lectionary before we start all over next Sunday with the Advent waiting for Christ to be born and Emmanuel, God, to be with us. Advent, of course, is supposed to be the season of waiting patiently, contemplatively, and quietly for the coming of Jesus. Again, I don't know about you, but it feels like Advent, this season of waiting perpetually, started all the way back in February. And we're still waiting and waiting and waiting for the birth of Jesus to save us from the status quo. Next Sunday, Advent 1, is the start of a whole new church year, filled again from the beginning with promise of joy, hope, peace, and the love of Christ. I am so ready for that. Happy New Year. So then, the question is, what does the lectionary, the traditional annual walk through the reading of the Bible that we do in church, leave us with at this end of the most unusual of ordinary times? What is the last word? We are left with the ultimate psalm of praise. Psalm 100. It feels almost ironic after 2020. After a year of lament, today we find ourselves being called back to the spiritual practice of praise. Dietrich Bonhoeffer was the Lutheran martyr theologian, German dissident during World War II, who wrote the book Life Together, a classic of modern Christianity. In it he wrote, "The Psalter, the Book of Psalms, is a vicarious prayer of Christ for the church. The prayer belongs not to individual members, but to the whole body of Christ. That is why the prayer of the Psalms belongs in a peculiar way to the whole fellowship, to all of us. Even if a verse or a psalm isn't one's own prayer, if you aren't feeling very praisey today, it is nevertheless the prayer of another member of the fellowship. So it is quite certainly the prayer of the true Jesus the Christ. In the Psalter, we learn to pray on the basis of Christ's prayer. The Book of Psalms, he concludes, is the great school of prayer." So today, according to Bonhoeffer, even if we don't really feel like it, we learn the spiritual practice of praise as a whole for each other's sake as the body of Christ. Today we celebrate the New Year's Eve of Christian tradition. We are called to offer a prayer of praise as the body of Christ, even if it isn't exactly how we're feeling today. Praise is a spiritual practice of the community for the sake of the whole. Just like the Psalms of Lament are for other times in our lives and community. What is it that we're meant to learn today from the great school of prayer for ourselves and for our world as we enter another season of waiting? I did a study, and I love doing these, of the Hebrew. And the word in Hebrew translated in our scripture from Psalm 100 as make a joyful noise is used 42 times in the Hebrew Bible or Old Testament. That is a significant amount of reoccurrence within biblical scholarship. This phrase is translated often as shout, cry, scream, vocalize, raise a sound, give a blast, have a blast. We are talking about an embodied experience of being Christian. Make a joyful noise. This is praising God, a creator, a lover, a giver, an essence, a breath, a sustainer, redeemer, as our whole selves. This is a psalm about finding hope again and the fundamentally human, necessary spiritual practice of praise. It isn't always natural for us, but it is something schooled per Bonhoeffer and practiced. We must have praise in our lives. In times of so much lament, on this New Year's Eve of the church, we are called back, as a final word, to the fundamental practice of praise. But Reverend, what is praise? It's a word I hear all the time in church, but what does that mean anyway? Enter God's gates with thanksgiving and God's courts with praise. What does this churchy word mean anyway? It's a word like narthex or steeple, but what does it mean in my real life? The English word from our translation that we know so well in the church, praise, is really interesting. It comes from the same Latin root as both the words prize and price. Prize, price, praise. The root is a word called pretium or pretium, meaning an assessment of worth or value. From an etymological perspective, when we praise God, we are assessing the worth, the prizedness of God's goodness in our lives. To praise is to sing, to shout, to pray, but it is also to affirm the value and importance of the sacred. It also means by the act of offering praise and worshiping God, we recognize our own worthiness and our own sacred worth to God the Creator, who desires our praise and relationship. Pretium, the finding of worth in relationship with the divine. To praise is a two-way street. It assesses the depth of our love for the divine, while it also affirms our own worth as beloved people of God. To praise is to validate the prize of life and the relationship with the sacred. This occurs 42 times in Hebrew scripture. This is a fundamental part about what it means to be human, and it has been missing from our lives for too long. We must learn the spiritual practice of praise, finding hope for the divine love of self and God, even in the midst of difficult times. We simply must. A brief illustration. One person, a secular saint, of course, who speaks the language of the sacred, and who understands praise as a musician, is the great and the only Dolly Parton. They say that Psalm 100 is a psalm of the musicians, people who have especially struggled in these COVID times. Dolly once told a story to a magazine in 1986 about a time when she especially was struggling. She called this time the time when the Bible brought her out of the shadows. Of a low point in her life when she was facing severe depression and when even Dolly Parton contemplated taking her own life. As she tells the story, as she was in the depth of that contemplation, God sent her puppy dog into her room to interrupt her with joy, and she realized that dog is God spelled backwards. The book, The Faith of Dolly Parton, describes this period in some detail. After that, she read the whole Bible cover to cover and found the courage of praise again. and she spent the rest of her life sharing the gospel of praise, worth of self, and the prize of God with others. Now, my favorite Christmas hymn isn't a hymn at all, but a Dolly Parton song. I know that makes me a bad clergy person, and I frankly don't care. It is a song that my mom, my sister, and I knew by heart growing up, and we'd sing at the top of our lungs, a family tradition completely out of tune on Christmas morning. Dolly Parton grew up in absolute poverty, and she once said, "In the midst of the direst poverty and despair, the human spirit, especially that of children, will find some hope to cling to, some promise of a better day." I believe that is the essence of praise, to find some hope to cling to, some promise of a better day. While she didn't write the song, Dolly made it famous, and she sang it from the heart from her own experience of poverty. Reflecting on her own childhood, when the only Christmas treat they could afford wasn't Christmas cookies or cakes, but simple, hard candy. And in it, they found hope, praise, and thanksgiving. Praise, both the work of the sacred in our lives and our own self-worth and hope for restarting and renewal and the possible. My favorite Christmas song is the essence of finding praise in the midst of poverty and simplicity of a hard candy Christmas. She sings, "Hey, maybe I'll dye my hair. Maybe I'll move somewhere. Maybe I'll get a car. Maybe I'll drive so far that I'll lose track. Maybe I'll bounce right back. Maybe I'll sleep real late. Maybe I'll lose some weight. Maybe I'll clear my junk. Maybe I'll just get drunk on apple wine. Bishops, of course. Me, I'll be just fine and dandy. Lord, it's like a hard candy Christmas. I'm barely getting through tomorrow. But still, I won't let sorrow bring me way down. I'll be fine and dandy. Lord, it's like a hard candy Christmas. I'm barely getting through tomorrow. But still, I won't let sorrow bring me way down." We have been living in a particularly quiet, separate, and isolating time. And we are likely to be honest, for quite some time yet. The scientists tell us we're not only in for a hard candy Christmas this year without caroling and family and travel and hugs and the way we're used to, but also a hard candy Thanksgiving, New Year's, Valentine's, maybe chocolate, and maybe even another hard candy Easter. And yet we are called, like Dolly Parton and like Dietrich Bonhoeffer, to the spiritual practice of praise from Psalm 100. To not just see the hard candy being the simplicity and the lack of all the things, as lament, but to find the praise of Psalm 100, not just for ourselves, but for our fellowship. "Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with singing and God's courts with praise." As we face Thanksgiving this next week, I invite you to join me in singing and working on our spiritual practice of praise as an essential lesson in our school of prayer. Me, I'll bounce right back. Lord, it's like a hard candy Christmas. I'm barely getting through tomorrow. But still, I won't let sorrow get me way down. We must learn the spiritual practice of praise, finding hope for the divine love of self-worth and of God, even in the difficult, hard candy times. We must. Praise be. Amen.